Welcome to the last part of the Storm Speaker series. And I want to encourage you to watch all 11 messages. But today we have a very special closing, concluding part of Storm Speaker that will involve you and how you can become a storm speaker.
It's so important for us to be people that have tools and we have weapons in our arsenal so that we can speak very diligently, very tactfully towards the storms in both our lives and other people's lives to see victory.
I hope you enjoyed today. I once again want to encourage you, go to our website at mycrossfire.com. You can pull down each and every one of the Storm Speaker series. I also want to encourage you that we are asking those who are listening, those who've been encouraged by this series, to write a testimony, not about Storm Speaker, but testimonies of where God has opened up the door for you to speak into a storm in your own life or in the life of someone else. We want to compile them and put together Storm Speaker stories. And that would include you and the places and ways God has used you miraculously to speak into those storms of life.
Again, we want to invite you to tune into all of the past Storm Speaker series messages, as well as this one today. If you are in our local area, I encourage you to come visit us for one of our church services. We have one at 9, 10, and 11. And if you, you can always watch us on our website at mycrossfire.com. You can go to our app and download our app, watch us on our app, and we can stay connected that way.
I also want to thank all of you who support this ministry and make it possible. Without your gifts and your financial support, we couldn't do what we do. But we know that God is faithful and He's working through you to not only speak to the storms of life, but to financially be faithful and to see God do miraculous things. Thank you for making this ministry possible by your yielding to what God has given to you and letting God use your finances to make a difference. I also want to thank you for your prayer and your prayer support. Again, go to our website. There's lots of places you can not only give, but you can also put your prayer requests and pray for others. Our website's a valuable tool, and I know that it will help you in your storm speaking and changing the world in which you live. Enjoy today's message. We've been on this series, and this is, you can breathe easy. This is the last of 11 messages. This will be the last one of 11 messages. Will I not speak on storm speakers again? Maybe or maybe not with that title, but I had someone say, you know, when we started and we went into COVID, you were speaking on this. I didn't title it the same, but you're exactly right. I was speaking on this then. Because folks, we have to understand as people of God, we have a mandate. We have a mandate. I want to say it one more time because that'll be emphatic. We have a mandate from God. This is what He has given you, that you are called to speak to the storms in your life and in the life of other people, into your family, into your business. You ready for this? Into the gas prices. Into this economy. Now, is it a storm? Yes. Will it end just because you say something? I'm going to tell you something. It won't if you don't. Once the enemy gets a foothold, we got a problem. It's the same in your life. Once the enemy gets a foothold, a stronghold, a stronghold means he's a hold of you in a way that it's not easy to let go. And you're going to have to get real with what the promises and the word of God, and you're going to have to declare, or you ready for this word? Prophesy God's word and God's promise. Now, when you say prophesy, that freaks people out. I'm not a prophet. You don't have to be a prophet to prophesy God's word. You're just a believer. Now, when you start declaring things that are in the future to come as emphatic, that is a prophet. But when you prophesy, you're literally just taking your testimony and you're taking God's word, And you're saying, this is what God says about this situation. You don't have to believe me, and you don't have to do it. But look around you. For just a minute, take a good look around you. And look at the people's lives who don't live for God that you know. And look at the lives of the people who do live for God. And decide what you want to be. And if you're living for God and your life is not attractive, it's not one that, you know, if it repulses the things of God and other people, you ought to probably live a little. You ought to probably enjoy yourself a bit. You ought to learn to have some fun and enjoy life. Because our young people ought to look at our lives not as, well, I live for God. I don't do anything wrong. I don't do anything fun. And I just, you know, no, that's not how it is. The greatest joy ever ought to come from people who speak the word, who know the truth, because the truth of God will set you free. But you've got to learn to say it in your own life and to the life of others. The review of this series is way more than I can do. I encourage you to go online. All of the 11 messages will be online. There's 10 on there now. And I really encourage you. We've talked about being taught, tested, and tried. They come from a root scripture, which is Luke chapter 8, Matthew chapter 8, and Mark chapter 4, where Jesus goes out into the water. He pushes out after having taught his disciples about faith. He teaches his disciples about faith, about being sure enough of what God said to act on it. He shoves them out. They could go out into the water to go to the other side. They had a purpose, the other side. When they get halfway, he falls asleep and a huge storm comes, one that they are afraid will tip them over. And by the way, all the other boats that were going with them. Notice that. There's actually boats going with them. So it wasn't only that they were in peril, but the people around them are in peril. And folks, I want to tell you, it's not only that your life might be in peril. We've got to be storm speakers because the lives of the people around us are in peril. And they need somebody who knows and has faith in God who will stand up and speak to those storms. That's you. Because your world is different than my world. Do you see that? Your people, the ones you surround yourself with, we're here as a body of Christ, but we literally have arms that reach out into the community. And our circle of influence, of family, of life, of being able to speak the word into people's lives is greater than what's here. What's here goes out as we become storm speakers. But when we become so involved and introverted into ourselves, then we silence the word of God. That's what the enemy wants, to silence the word of God in you. And if he can say, well, just keep to yourself and your family, then he'll settle for that. But what he doesn't want is you to reach out beyond anything else. And he'd like to victimize your family. So the Lord speaks to the storm because the disciples didn't listen to what they were taught. But that was not the end all. The end all was that he was going to face the enemy. He was going to face demons. And he would cast those demons out. And when he did so, he didn't take that demon-possessed man out of his city, just like he doesn't take you out of the world. You have a life to lead and a life to live right here on this earth. And when God has done something great, like cast a legion of demons out of you into a bunch of pigs and they jump off a cliff, I want to tell you, we all have a testimony. It all looks a little different. It all is going to reach people in a different way, but every one of you who love God and have allowed him to work in your life and you began to speak to your storms, God has given you a testimony that you can begin to speak out into others. And when the demon-possessed man said, "Man, I want to go with you, Jesus," Jesus said, "Wait a second. No, you got a job to do in all of Decapolis, which is 11 cities, 10 or 11 cities on that side that were that whole region was affected by his testimony by simply walking down the street and them seeing him and saying, "What happened to you? You are not that crazed, demon-possessed man. What happened to you?" And he would share, and it affected that whole region. And we see testimony after testimony after testimony just like that. And so today we're going to do something a little different. And I'm going to scare you right now. This is where you start to look for your exit. I'm going to tell you ahead of time right now. I want you to see that there's this note page. You have your normal note pages. You know, those are just for you to follow along. Don't worry, we won't make it through that. Rarely do. But on this back page right here, there's something for you. And it's not for you to take home. In fact, I rarely tell you, you can write while we're speaking. Today I'm going to tell you, you can write while we're speaking. If you're watching online and you haven't downloaded these off of our app or our website, I want to ask you to do this. If you haven't or don't know how to do that, then get ready to write it down. I'm about to read it, and I'll read it quick. So get your paper and pen and get ready. It's time we all prophesy. What does that mean? Well, whatever God has done in your life, you're about to proclaim it. Okay? Here's what we do at the church. This ain't the scary place. If it was scary, I'd approach everything a lot different. This is the family place. If I want my kids to have a good work ethic, you know what I do? I make them do some stuff at home. I teach them that it's important to have a work ethic at home so that when they go out of the house, they can work somewhere. And what do they have? A good work ethic. Now, is it easy for me to follow my kids around and be like, "Okay, you pick that up. You pick that up. You pick that up. No, see that. Pick that up. Take it over to the sink. No, it doesn't go in the dishwasher yet. You got to wash it." And your kid looks at you and goes, "I have to wash it to put it in the washer?" Yes. Yes, you do. Because we microwave cook around here in our dishes, and that cooks it right on. You know, and then you teach them and you say, "Okay, and put it in the dishwasher." "No, not there. Put it down there." "No, not there. Put it down there." How easy would it have been for me to just pick it up and stick it in the dishwasher? Way easier than that. With a whole lot less hassle, a whole lot less attitude, right? And my kids would in the short run love me a whole lot more. Right? Am I right? But I do it because I love my kids. I do it because I need them to know how to do that simple task, how to follow instructions, because I love them enough that when they learn to do that, they'll be a different person. In this church today, we are going to be at home when it's safe, when you're not getting fired, you can't do it wrong. If you break it, you're breaking our own stuff. If you mess up, you're messing up our own stuff. This is the time you should actually put to practice what we're talking about. You're like, "Oh, freaking out a little bit. Oh my goodness, what's he gonna make me do? What's he gonna make me do? What's he gonna make me do?" I'm gonna make you do anything. But you know what? We're gonna get some dishes cleaned up. Okay? So, Jesus taught him. He tested him. And then he tried it out. Let's do that today. Acts chapter 2. "And it shall come to pass in the last days, says God, I will pour out my spirit on all flesh. Your sons and your daughters shall prophesy. Your young men will see vision. Your old men will dream dreams. And on your men servants and your maid servants, men and women, I will pour my spirit out in those days." and they shall prophesy. Okay. Now, some of you might have an out in this day that we live. It didn't say only young women prophesy and young men. And all this old one are going to dream dreams. That did not what it said. It ended with, in the last days, I will pour my spirit on all of those. All of them. And they shall proclaim the word of God. Preach the word of God. Share their testimony and what God has done in their life. Just like Jesus did, he taught them, he healed them, and they shared the gospel. He taught his disciples and they shared the gospel. That's what we're called to do today. You and I, today. And it was for all of them. The only out you have, if you're a male or a female, you're supposed to prophesy. If you're confused, I guess you don't have to prophesy. It might be better you don't. I don't know. If you got a womb, you're a woman. And men, you hopefully got it figured out. Just look down. Okay? It's real simple. God poured his spirit out on all of us. We're called to be men and women of God. And he wants us to share it. What's that look like? In 1 Corinthians 14:1-5, pursue love and desire spiritual gifts, especially that you would prophesy. For he who speaks in a tongue does not speak to men, but to God. I want to tell you something. If you're not speaking to God, you probably ain't got much to say. You ought to start speaking to God. In an unknown tongue or a known tongue, if I was you, I'd let my spirit start praying to God so I have something to say. I need God to speak to me. And then he says, no one understands him. However, in the spirit, he speaks mysteries. But he who prophesies speaks edification and exhortation and comfort to men. How bad is that? How hard is that? Is that impossible? No. When you prophesy, you're taking the word of God that is always current and you're speaking it into a situation at the right time, at the right moment. That's what we've been 10 messages on. That's why we're writing a book on this. That's why I'm asking for your stories so we either have the end of the book or the companion book that you would write out your stories of when God has brought a situation to you and you've spoke to it and God's word has brought healing and peace into a very desperate situation. We want this to be something we do as a church. You're going to hear us ask and ask and ask and ask and ask until we actually get them. Because folks, this church, the story is not written from the pulpit. The story is written when you go out of this church and God does amazing things. 1 Corinthians 14, pursue love, desire spiritual gifts, but especially that you may prophesy. Let's prophesy. In verse 4, he who speaks in a tongue edifies himself. You need to do that. But he who prophesies edifies the entire church. And then from there, the church goes out and edifies and changes the world. That's the mission. You know, we do television and have for 28 years. You know why we do television? Because we get out of the four walls of the church. You know what the purpose and the greatest outreach of this church is? It ain't television, for Lord's sake. It just gets the message out of the walls of the church. How do they think the message is supposed to get out of the walls of the church, huh? How does it do that? You learn to prophesy. You learn to speak to storms. When someone's going through something, you don't shy away. You don't be like, oh, I'll pray for you. You go out and you say, hey, let me pray for you. You say, hey, you know what? This is the wisdom of God concerning this. And you speak into it. Is it difficult? Sure. You got to hear from the Lord? Yeah. You got to know the scripture? Yeah. And if you don't know, what do you say? I don't know. Someone asks you a question. We're all so afraid of all the questions people are going to ask us. What do you say? I don't know. But this I do know. I was blind. Now I can see. Praise Jesus. 5. I wish you all spoke with tongues. Oh, by the way, the end of that chapter, he says, do not forbid anyone from speaking in tongues. Read your Bible. We've used this scripture historically, they've tried to use this scripture to discount speaking in tongues when all it does is says you get what's right, right, and it's first, edify yourself, and then edify the body of Christ. Don't go try to edify the body of Christ by speaking the way you speak to God to people. Speak to people the way God speaks to people because he's speaking through you, and don't not do that. That was a double negative? There you go. Verse 5, I wish you all spoke with tongues, but even more, because of the benefit of everyone, even more that you would prophesy. For he who prophesies is greater or produces greater value. I want you to see that. What he's saying is, when you speak, you're bringing great value to the kingdom of God. When you prophesy, he who prophesies is greater than he who speaks with tongues, unless he interprets that the church may be edified. Why do we speak to the church? So the church will speak to the storms. Why did Jesus teach his disciples, test his disciples, and then put it to action? Why? Well, because he was teaching them, just like I teach my kid to put away the dishes and put them in the dishwasher. He was teaching them something that was going to help them when he wasn't around. And guess what? He's not on this earth, and he left you here, just like he left that demoniac that was delivered, so that until he ended his life, he would speak the word of God. This morning, I want you to receive a word with the intention to give it away. You say, well, how do I know what someone needs? You don't. God does. And you know what? You may not be right. It's okay. You're going to edify them. You're going to bring some lifting up, some encouragement. So it doesn't matter. A word of testimony. This is it. I want you to write out a word of testimony, something God has done. Have it on your lips. You should do this every day. Look at what God did one day or last week. Have it on your lips and be ready to share it all the time. Number two, a promise. Something current that God gave you, a word of God, something, a scripture. Every day, have something ready. Can I tell you, if you have a readied scripture, write it down if you can't memorize it and carry it with you. You know what? God is going to let you use that in your family, in your life, with somebody at work. He's going to let you use it. Carry it around. And when you pull it out of your pocket and you go, that's really crazy. Watch this. This is what I have in my pocket God gave me today. And you read it to them, it will change their life. You say, that won't happen. I want to tell you something. You do it 10 times, I'll guarantee it'll happen once. I bet if you did it every day, if you get out in the community at all, if you talk to people at all, you know what? God's going to use it every day. You say, well, how do I know what scripture? I don't care. It's what ministers to you. Just hold it in your pocket, because God's word, every one of them has a scripture, has something to give. All right. Always be open to receive from the Spirit. Always be open to receive from the Spirit. In other words, just be ready for God to do whatever as it flows, to give wisdom as it flows. All right, the last thing is this. Receive a word for your growth or healing. What is it that you need? Maybe you need healing. And in a few minutes, we're going to pray for each other. In a few minutes, we're going to speak a word of encouragement. In a few minutes, I'm going to have you just share a testimony. You know, your favorite scripture, Jesus wept. I don't know why that means something to you, but it was the shortest one and you thought of it, you know? John 3:16, for God so loved the world, and you're just going to share it. Why? It's because it's the only one you remember. I don't care. Write down some of this stuff and then write down what you need. You know what? In a major case today, not because of sheer numbers, somebody's going to actually bring you what you need. So the first ones is how you receive from God to give. The other one is something you need. What do you need? What do you need? Well, when someone comes over to you and says, hey, can I pray with you? Give them what you need. Now, some of you, don't freak out. I'm not going to force it on anybody. If you keep your butt in the chair, we'll just sit here, pray, and be done. But if you want to actually take the last 11 weeks of our hard work to practice, you might change the world. Christy, come and share what this all means, and I'll follow it up from there.
Share what this all means. That's a lot. So I'm going to speak briefly about how important it is that we armor and we gather it up. In the Bible, it talks about the children of Israel, when they wandered in the wilderness, God provided for them manna every day from heaven. And God sent it. We know, if you know the story, I'm not going to read it all, but it's in Exodus chapter 16. It talks about how that God provided manna every single day. So every day God would send manna, you know, from heaven, and it would be on the ground and they would retrieve it. They would be able to eat of it. And initially, you know, because we're human beings, we're a little dense, a little thick-headed, you know, they would just stockpile it up. And he said, don't stockpile it because tomorrow it's going to be full of worms. So like, we know that it's not intended to last day after day after day, except for the Sabbath. The Sabbath, you could retrieve enough for 2 days and it would make it last. It was literally a miracle from heaven, right? It's having this thing, you know, the word manna means what is it even? So this manna, this bread from heaven would fall and they would go and they would collect it. And one of the things that I was reminded of as Aaron and I were kind of chatting through this is it's so important that we are receiving something fresh from the Lord every single day, right? We have to, you know, like Pastor Aaron just said, you know, we have to load our weapon. We have to load our quiver. We go out into this world, we go completely unarmed, and then we wonder why we're under the onslaught of the enemy. We wonder why, you know, like the enemy's getting all the pot shots at us, and we're not feeling victorious. Well, we have to armor up, you know, and armor up, I'm not talking about the armor of God. I'm talking about get some weapons in your quiver, get some weapons in your arsenal. Let's get some things in us so that we know what we are working with. We know the weapons of our warfare. We know how to fight this thing. God gives us a fresh supply for each day. We aren't supposed to live off old manna. We must gather fresh manna from him every day. You know, one of the things Pastor Aaron was going to talk about, and I don't know if he is going to today at the latter part of his message, we were talking about finding the gold and like retrieving the gold in us, you know, retrieving the gold in God's word, retrieving the gold in who God's called us to be. And, you know, gold is what? It's pure. It's without any, it's not tainted in any way, just like God's word. But here's the thing is, how do you get gold? It's rarely just sitting at the surface, right? You usually have to dig out gold. You have to mine it. You have to get to it. And you have to retrieve it, right? But then the exact same way with manna, you know, from the manna from heaven, it wasn't like the children of Israel just sat and was like. But oftentimes, we walk around expecting God just to, like, drop it right in our mouths or drop it right around us. But God says, pick it up, and don't just pick it up, devour it, eat of it, partake of it, so that it's something that is in our arsenal. It's something that we can have and have a hold of. We need to gather it up and we need to eat it. You ever hear people say, you know, hey, I don't want to go to this church anymore because I'm just not getting fed. Well, don't say that to me because I will laugh at your face. No, because here's the deal. In scripture, show me one scripture that says that the church is supposed to feed you or the pastor is supposed to feed you. It's not in the Bible. You won't find it. It's not there. You want to know why? Because there's a smorgasbord out for you. There's this a buffet in front of you of everything that God wants to give you, right? It doesn't matter if it's awesome in front of you. If you don't partake of it, it's really just going to go to waste. It's really just going to rot on the vine. But God tells us to partake of it and to eat of it. In our daily lives, we come to a Sunday morning service, we receive from the Lord. But the truth is if we only ate physical food on Sundays, by Tuesday, Wednesday, heck, by Monday afternoon, you probably are hungry. Yeah, you're going to be starving. In the very same way, we need to eat spiritually. We need to partake of something spiritually so that we have something, right? So we're not walking around weary. Yeah, well, I gorged myself on Sunday, and I had this awesome, I was overflowing. I was so full. I was like sick full on Sunday. Okay, but are you sick full all week from one event? No. You use it. Your body uses it. Your life uses it. The very same way, you know, when we pour in the word of God, our life uses it. And we need to continually be filling ourselves up and have something that is fruitful in our lives. Number two, his word has a purpose and a destination. So we now know that God's word has a purpose and has destination. Just like the enemy. The enemy shoots fiery darts at our lives. And God, the enemy doesn't just shoot fiery darts just erroneously into the atmosphere, hoping that they're going to hit something. No, the enemy shoots fiery darts at your life, and he has a destination for every single fiery dart he shoots. The destination is a weakness, it's a temptation, it's a place of discouragement, it's depression, it's a crack in your... The enemy knows the cracks, and he's going to shoot every fiery dart that he shoots at your life at a weak spot in you, at a place that maybe you're discouraged, at a place where maybe, you know, there's despair, maybe a place of temptation, maybe a place of addiction, maybe a place that you're free, but the enemy wants to check and see if you're really free, if you're really walking in freedom, right? So the enemy's shooting fiery darts at your... So how do we combat that, right? Those are the storms of life that we talk about. These are these storms that happen in our lives that brew over our lives. Well, the enemy shoots these fiery darts at us. And how do we combat that? We combat that by having something in our arsenal. And we have to be people that are consistently filling ourselves up so that we can combat it. Because just like the enemy's darts have a destination, God's word has a destination. And that destination is powerful. It's effective. God's word says that it's effective. The prayers of a righteous man are powerful and effective, is what it says in James. So we know that it's not just, we're not throwing prayers and throwing scriptures out into the atmosphere, hoping that they're going to stick to something, but we can also, in the very same way that the enemy shoots fiery darts at us, we can also combat them directly with the word of God, with the truth of God, with the promises of God that we know. But if we don't know them and they're not in the arsenal of our lives, we're walking around with unloaded weapons. 2 Timothy 3, we're going to read this. Tell me if it sounds anything like the world we're living in today. It says, but mark this, there will be terrible times in the last days. People will be lovers of themselves, lovers of money, boastful, proud, abusive, disobedient to their parents, ungrateful, unholy, without love, unforgiving, slanderous, without self-control, brutal, not lovers of good, treacherous, rash, conceited, lovers of pleasure rather than lovers of God, having a form of godliness but denying its power. I don't know about you, but I just feel like that's kind of nailed it. But this scripture right here, it says, having a form of godliness but denying its power. What do you think that means? I go to church every Sunday. I got every Christian t-shirt you can imagine. I got bumper stickers for days. I advertise that I am this thing. But I look like Rambo. I look like a G.I. Joe. But they're all empty. I don't have a single bullet in a single one of my guns. I don't have a single arrow in a single one of my weapons. But I want to look like Rambo. I want to look like a G.I. Joe. I want to look like somebody in the Lord's arm. God wants us to succeed, but as much as God wants us to succeed, the enemy wants us to fail. Right? So when you put on your Rambo gear and you haven't you loaded anything in your arsenal and you have nothing, but you're going to wear all your Christian, do you know that the enemy is going to try to expose a fake? He's going to try to expose a fake. He's going to push and crack till you bust. He's going to squeeze to see what comes out, because that's what the enemy does. We've talked about this a lot in this message series. When you're squeezed, what comes out? The enemy is going to squeeze, and he's going to shoot, and he's going to do the things that he can do to try to get you to crack. Now you might be like, well, so I'm not supposed to wear Christian t-shirts? Is that what you're telling me? I need to take the bumper stickers off my car? No, what I'm telling you is equip yourself. It's not about what you display. You do not want to be somebody who appears like it, but lacks the power. Because I guarantee it that the enemy knows if it's fake or if it's real. And he is in the business of trying to expose it. So when we're squeezed, and the goodness of God and the truth of God and the word of God comes out, what does that do? It extinguishes the fiery darts of the enemy in our lives. God does not want us to be people that deny the power, that we have a form of godliness. It looks good. I go to church every single Sunday. I serve. I clean the church. I work in the nursery. I do all these things. But do you ever pick up your Bible during the week? I do all the things. I put on the dog. I make it look real good. But have I put anything in my weapons? Because
Not just do I need them, but you need them from me. I need them from you. We need each other. I can't walk around just relying that all of my blind spots are always clear. The truth is, I don't see my blind spots. I don't see my weak spots. I don't see my blind spots. But you can see things in me that I don't see, and I see things in you that you don't see. And we need each other. God has a purpose. His word has a destination. And if we don't put it in us, it can't come out of us. If we don't have anything, you might go, man, I was reading the word of God today and I got this little nugget. Well, it's just for me, so surely it can't be for somebody else. Do you think that maybe God illuminated something in your... Do you think that God's so small that he could just show something that would only be for you in a day? Do you think that God's so small that he'll illuminate a word and you're like, oh man, surely that's just for me. But what if you stuck that word of God you got, what if you stuck it in your pocket? And what if it was even more powerful, even more redeeming, even more freeing, even more chain-breaking for someone else than it ever was for you? Why do we think, oh, well, I just, that was just for me. What about when we get a nugget from the Lord that we go, I'm going to put that in my pocket because there's probably somebody who needs that more than I did today. What? There's probably some storms brewing around me that maybe God's going to send me to speak to. But he can't send me if I just look like a G.I. Joe and a Rambo when somebody goes, hey, help me fight this. I don't know how to fight that. Let me call the pastor. No, we should have some things in our quiver. We should have some things in our arsenal so that we can actually fight. I'm going to skip down to verse 12. It says, and in fact, everyone who wants to live a godly life in Christ Jesus will be persecuted, while evil men and imposters will go from bad to worse, deceiving and being deceived. But as for you, continue in what you have learned and become convinced of, because you know those from whom you learned it, and how from infancy you have known the Holy Scriptures, which you are able to make you wise for salvation through faith in Jesus Christ. Because all Scripture is God-breathed. All of it's God-breathed. And it's useful. It has a destination for teaching, for rebuking, for correcting, and training. Now, you might go like, okay, well, I'm going to rebuke you, and I'm going to train you, and I'm going to correct you, and no. Because God's word in me applied rebukes me, trains me, shaves me, molds me, makes me look more like him, so that I can be thoroughly equipped for every good work. Not for just my good works, but for the works that we need each other for. Thoroughly equipped for every good work. Because in Hebrews 4:12 it says, for the word of God is living, it's powerful, and it's sharper than any two-edged sword. It pierces even to the division of soul and spirit, of joints and marrow. It is the discerner of thoughts and the intents of the heart. God's word is powerful, and it has a destination. Amen. Pastor Aaron.
All right. You got a scripture ready? All right. Michael, I love you.
Come on up here.
Okay.
He calls me and asked me to come to, he said, let's have lunch. And then he blessed the socks off me. Yeah. What God can do.
Yeah.
Go for it.
Well, I'm 42 years old. And for the last 28 years of my life, I was an addict. I was addicted to meth. I was an alcoholic, you name it. In 2019, I was diagnosed with schizophrenia. But to tell you the truth, I was demon possessed. It was horrible. I came to Oregon.
When did you find that out?
Seeking God, really, the Holy Spirit just talked to me, and I asked what's wrong with me and stuff like that, and God just opened up my eyes. I was able to see these demons that were possessing me, where they were in my home, they were in my family's home, and it literally just showed me that for years, for generations, this demon has been possessing my family and has been wiping us all out. You know, I've had uncles die from alcohol and, you know, all kinds of things, just in and out of jail. And God just opened up my eyes and just showed me all these things, what's happening to me. And I was just continuing to see God, and the devil was just beating me down, and he still does, you know. and I could still hear him, but I just keep trying to, you know, just fight him off with scripture and whatnot. So I've been sober off of methamphetamines for over 2 years. And as far as alcohol, the last time I relapsed was a year ago. But, you know, I just keep seeking God, and I'm the first person to graduate college. I graduated yesterday, matter of fact. Yeah, I graduated with 7 degrees, and you know, it's just, I just crave God, learning about God and fellowship with people, talking about God and stuff like that. And before, it was not always like that. It was drugs, alcohol, you know, like bad women and stuff like that. And now I just like want to share my story with everybody that I talk to, or, you know, whoever. Like when I see people like talking in the streets, it was like, that was me. That's who I was. And if God can change me, like, he could definitely change you. You just got to keep at it and ask him and just let him in, let him in. And my fiance, she was an atheist, and now she's, you know, praying and thanking God and stuff like that. And it's God's just been real. He exists. The Bible is real. And I just want to tell everybody to keep, you know, just seeking God and reading your Bible and stuff like that and praying, because he really does exist, and he really does bring you out of, you know, turmoil. And I know Pastor Christy would talk about it. I think she says, get all that yuck off of you, but I call it ick. And you just literally just feel all these layers and layers of ick just break off of you. Every day when you wake up, just pray, and, you know, go to bed, you just pray, and it works, you know. But yeah, works.
Awesome. Thank you. That's awesome. Thank you for sharing that with us. So he said, I was just reading the Bible, realized that that's me. I'm demon possessed. And that's what they're calling. Those demons are calling themselves the same stuff. And so I just said, I'm done with that. Folks, you know what? What are you waiting for? You're waiting for somebody to come cast a demon out? You got a demon. You got a stronghold. Get rid of it. Don't stand for it anymore. You have power in the name of Jesus. All right. I'm gonna do this real quick highlight, and then we're going to pray for each other. If you don't want to, that's fine. Don't freak out. I don't want you to if you don't want to. How many have ever seen a light bulb, like a real light bulb, like the old ones, right? Now, when you plug that in, I stole this from somebody this weekend that I listened to, a lady named Janelle. And if you plug that in, the light bulb in, how much power is that? 110, right? It's enough power to blow that light bulb right out of your hand. Okay, if you go to the Philippines, you plug it in, you probably are going to blow it up. It's got 220, right? How much does that light bulb put off? Well, it depends. It's a 60-watt light bulb, 100-watt light bulb. Those are watts. So what stops that amazing amount of power coming from just blowing that thing out of your hand? Or what stops it from, listen to this, what stops it from being 60 when it could be 100 or 500. It's called resistance. You got a resistor. It resists you. It resists that power. Can I just tell that there's a whole bunch of you plugging into God with a whole lot of power? There's a whole lot of power. And you're the resistance that's slowing it down. And your light isn't shining as bright as it could because you've got a resistor in there limiting how much will flow through you. God's not resisting, you're resisting. You're supposed to be resisting the devil, you're resisting God. Quit resisting God. Let him become powerful in you. Let your light shine much brighter. Let your capacity to shine the light increase. You can get that out of Ephesians 5, 8 through 21. I don't have time to read it. They're in your notes. Number 4, every miracle deserves a testimony. You've heard me preach on this. That demon-possessed man in Decapolis, folks, when Jesus spoke to him, he went around and shared his testimony of what God had done. Michael shared his testimony of what God has done, not what God did to save me 20 years ago. What did God do yesterday to save you? What did he do last week, last month, last year? My greater testimony, I can't get up here and share how I came to Jesus every single Sunday. You'd all just quit coming. You'd be like, I heard that a million times. You don't want to hear about how God did it, you know, 50 years ago. You want to know God's saving me right now. Those testimonies are good once in a while, but I got to have something fresh, some fresh manna like Christy talked about. What's your testimony? Jesus says we literally defeat the enemy with the word of our testimony. What is the substance of your faith? What is the substance? It is your testimony. If he did it for you, he can do it for me. If he did it then, he can do it now. If he did it for me, he can do it for you. See, your testimony shows people that. What is the value of your story? What is the value of your testimony? What is the value of God's word? Listen, it gives you an incorruptible crown, a crown that can't be corrupted. Gold that cannot, it can change shape, but it will not be done away with. An incorruptible crown for those who live a discipled life. 1 Corinthians 9:25. I left it in your notes. For those who patiently endure trials and testings, James 1:12. For those who are faithfully care for the flock, 1 Peter 5:2-4. For those who love his appearing or are waiting and looking for his return or the day that they stand before him, 2 Timothy 4:8. For those who the crown of rejoicing will be to those who are faithful and soul winners, 1 Thessalonians 2:19-20, folks, you receive a crown or a heritage. This is what it says in 2 Timothy 4:6-8. I am already being poured out as a drink offering. Keep the Lobb family in your prayers. Mindy Lobb went home to be with Jesus this week, leaving her three boys and her son, or three boys and her husband. And folks, we don't have her to cry for. You can cry for her children, but she is before the presence of the Lord rejoicing. And I want to tell you, I am so thankful that she fought the good fight. She finished her race. And before her is the faith of God, laid up a crown of righteousness, which the Lord, the great and righteous judge, will give me on that day, Paul says, and not me alone, but everyone who's looking and longing for his appearing. That's you. Power of this story, here's how it ends. We overcome in Jesus Christ. We overcome in Jesus Christ. John 16:33. I have said these things to you, that in you, you may have peace. Why are you going to speak to other people? To show them peace. To show them the love of God. To show them the power of God. In the world, you will have tribulation. Why are you going to be a storm speaker today and every day? Why are you going to put a scripture in your pocket to see how God uses it in other people's lives? Why are you going to do that? Right here. Because in this world, every one of us have tribulation. Every one of us are going to have troubles. He promised it. But like that man who's been set free by Jesus, we're going to go around and defeat the enemy and defeat those tribulations and share the word of God and share our testimony and be a light unto the world, folks. He says, you're going to have tribulation, but don't worry. I've overcome the world. And he's made you and I overcomers through Christ Jesus. Why don't we tell somebody about it? So here's how we're going to do it. Here's your opportunity. You are called to prophesy. I'm going to ask every one of you who are willing to say, you know what? God has given me something. I'm going to give it away. He gave it to me. I'm going to make some room for more. How many of you guys have a DVR at your house? Thing that records TV shows or Okay, I'm the only one. All right, no, there's a couple of us. Okay. You know, I go on a trip and I come back, that thing auto records. It's full. Well, if I want to watch anything new, I got to get rid of some of it. Some of you are holding on to stuff that God did and your bitterness and your anger and the good things, but you ain't got nothing new getting recorded. You want to know what you do? Give away the stuff you have. Give it away and make room for some more. Give away, tell your story so God can give you some more. So here's what I'm going to ask you to do. If you're ready to be a storm speaker after 11 weeks of tilling some ground, you're ready to be a storm speaker, I want you to stand to your feet and come across the front. Come on. Get up here. Get across the front. We're going to do it. We're not going to talk about it. We're going to do it. Come on. If you're ready, we're going to do it. Just get out from where you're at and say, you know what? What am I going to do? I don't know. Could you encourage someone? Could you speak life to someone? Could you speak the word to someone? Yeah, line up just like you're all on the prayer team. Now, let me tell you something. Where's the best place to practice serving Jesus? Right here in church. Right here, right now. If somebody gives you a word from the Lord, tells you to jump off a cliff, I wouldn't do it, guys. These guys are new at this, okay? But I want to tell you, God's word's in them. So here's what I'm going to do. Look at this. What if this was the prayer team? Hey, could we have someone who want to come up and pray for you? You know, hey, I got some people who want to accept Jesus. Could we all come up? Now, you need a badge. You need some training, all that stuff. But could you imagine if this is what it was like every Sunday morning? Our visitors would be like, oh, my Lord, what is up with them? They're all looking at me. Awesome. Okay, so what do I say to a prayer team member if people don't come up to receive prayer? Go pray for one another. So here's what I'm going to do first. Now, you may not have felt comfortable coming up to pray, but if you're here today and you need someone to pray for you, you got a whole bunch to choose from. Maybe there's somebody who spoke in your life, or maybe they just look pretty. I don't know. If you would like God to speak into your life and they would pray for you, they might give a word of encouragement. They might give a word of testimony. They're going to do that. That's how we're going to end. Boy, this is scary for all of you. Could you step out from where you're at and have one of these just pray with you? Come on. If that's you, would you do that? Would you just submit and let them just give a word and speak to your storm, speak to your, just go up to them. They're going to pray. Wait, don't start praying yet, but just go ahead and come on up. That's good. Come on up. Anyone else? You just want to come up and get prayer from somebody here. All right. Now here's what we're going to do, guys. I'm going to ask you now, I'm going to pray, and as soon as I'm done praying, I just want you to turn to one another, find somebody up here, and I want you to just speak a word of encouragement to them. I want, if you've got a problem or you're struggling or there's a tribulation, you can look at them and just say, hey, could you pray for me? You don't need a degree. All you need to know is Jesus. That's it. And if you don't know Jesus, turn to one of the people next to you and say, hey, I don't really know Jesus. I've never confessed him and never asked him into my heart. Would you help me? Heavenly Father, I just thank you right now for this group of people. Lord, we're going to speak to the storms in our lives, the storms in ourselves, the storms around us, Lord. We're going to speak the word of God and see it not return void, but watch it have power in Jesus' name, Lord. Lord, I ask that today, Lord, we would begin to speak words of life to one another, that, Lord, we would begin to release the power of God to bring change and life and healing in Jesus' name. Amen. Can we do that now? Find someone to pray with. Get in a group of one, two, three, four. It doesn't matter. And then just prophesy to one another, because that's what it is. You're literally prophesying. If there's anyone that doesn't know Jesus, then pray with them to accept Christ as their Savior. Come on. Let's do it before we leave. Move around if you need to. Find someone to pray with. As different ones were praying together, I want to encourage you, if you do not know the Lord Jesus as your personal Lord and Savior, we would like to pray with you. You can simply call us at 541-686-FIRE. That's 541-686-FIRE. We would love to pray with you. If you don't get an immediate answer to the call, we would encourage you to leave a message, and one of our counselors or prayer warriors will call you back, and they would love to pray with you. I also encourage you to write out some of the storms that you've went through where God has showed himself faithful and the word of God has come back to bring life and change. We would love to hear your testimony of what God is doing. Just a paragraph or a page or two. We want to put them together as a collection of storm speaker stories.
I want to remind you also, it is so imperative for us as believers to be getting fresh manna every single day. We do not want to be the body of believers who have an appearance of godliness, but we lack the power. But we want to be people that have an arsenal in our tool belt of weapons that help us to defeat and deflect the enemy, to speak into storms, to make a difference in the world that we live. God has called us to be world changers. He's called us to be storm speakers. So I encourage you, let's fill up every single day. Let's get fresh manna from the Lord every single day, and let's apply it. Let's use it for God's kingdom.
I hope you've enjoyed this series. Again, I encourage you to go to the website, www.mycrossfire.com, where you can get not only this series, but multiple places and resources and series and different ways you could get involved right here at Crossfire. If you happen to live in the Eugene Springfield area, we'd love to have you visit live in one of our services or outreaches or feeding programs or youth or men's or women's or children events. There's so many different ways you can plug in and become discipled and work and outreach. That's all found on our website, or you can call us. We'd love to hear from you. Saying that, it is the financial support and it is prayer support that is so needed. And we encourage you that at whatever degree or level that you appreciate this ministry, would you sow into this ministry financially so that we can continue to disciple, continue to increase the kingdom of God. And we do so as we bind together as the body of Christ. And so thank you for joining with us and so many others that make up this incredible ministry of Crossfire. And we've endured the difficult, the highs, the lows, the good things said about you and all the crazy bad things that people like to say. But I have to say that as we've endured now for well over 30 years, God has always been faithful when we've spoke to the storm, when we've spoken into the adversity. God has always allowed us to overcome. And I thank the Lord for that. And I know it'll happen in your life also.
I hope that this message series has not only just encouraged you, but I hope it has empowered you to realize that, you know, not the pastor or the spiritual leaders over you are the ones that are the storm speakers, but that it's in us and that God has called us to be people that speak into our own storms, that we speak into our own lives, our own families, but we speak into the storms that are around us everywhere we go, that we can be life givers and hope givers and joy bringers everywhere we go through the power of God's word.
We'll see you next week right here on Crossfire Television. Once again, bringing the word of God and doing it not just by television, but every day into the lives of people throughout the world. Thank you for being a part of that.
Amen.
Crossfire World Outreach Ministries is supported by faithful monthly contributions from viewers like you. Please take time today and make your tax-deductible gift to Crossfire World Outreach Ministries, 942 28th Street, Springfield, Oregon, 97477. 541-686-3473, or find us on the web at mycrossfire.com.